Good afternoon, all. Thanks for being here. I know Nick is talking in the other room, so it's a bit of a competition, but I'm glad you choose us. I hope you won't be disappointed by the end of this series of Microtalks. The first one, so as many of you know, we are in the process of editing the book, the game user research book. So I'm Pejman, I'm the user research director at the Execution Lab and assistant professor at UIT. Leonard, you all probably know him. He's associate professor at the University of Waterloo, and we have our other colleague, Andres Trachen, who is now a professor at, from tomorrow, professor at York University in the UK. So we are all together are co-editing this book. So in the next few minutes, I'm gonna provide some quick updates, and then we're gonna have a few minutes for question and answer. First of all, we have one slide only. So the word cloud is kind of the titles of the chapters we have. And the nice little bubble of images are lovely authors.
Beautiful people.
You see the different sizes? That doesn't mean they're less or more important. It's just to make it more exciting. So about the book, so I'm going to talk about our vision slightly. So obviously, we want to do an awesome book. But apart from that, the book, it aims for people who are entering this field. So it's not for people who are in the field for many years. It's a kind of a first book that you probably want to give to your students or new hires or people who are kind of maybe joining from other fields, like maybe they're web designers and then they're moving to...
If I can stop you there, there's three editors, so there's some disagreement between us at all times. This book, yes, it is for students, but as we regularly fight over, it is also for industry professionals, just as a nice book to have on the side of your coffee table and just kind of to look up that thing that you forgot about. It's a really useful book, not just for students.
So as I said, like for those who you may just hire and like, okay, here is a book you probably need to read before you start. And as part of that vision, we tried to negotiate a deal with the publisher, who is the Oxford University Press, to make the book cheap. So what we are... targeting is below $100, probably around $60 to $70. So that's the price that we
50 are, is what I said.
We are aiming.
We'll see.
That's our one of our visions. So to have a book that's accessible, that's for people who are joining the industry. But the second vision, we wanted the book that is created by the community. So
this is you.
So at the very beginning, we invited. Let's say, I would say, senior member of the community to be on the advising panel. So we have 13 advisors that help us to basically come up with each chapter that we want. And then in terms of recruiting the authors, we have 30 plus authors that contributed to this book. And many of you here have wrote the chapter for us, and we are so thankful for that. And
most of you are actually in the other room right now, but that's okay.
So that's our basically... those are the visions for the book. In terms of some updates, we have 25 chapters, or maybe more than 25 chapters, and we see them in three different sections. So there are chapters on production side, so looking at gear in production, gear in post-production, game user research framework, game user research process, building the lab, building your user research lab, and these are all written by experts in the in this industry. Basically, me, Leonard, and Andres, we probably all together, we have maybe two or three chapters. The rest is written by the community. Basically.
You.
Then there is a method section, which we reviewed like the best practices for all the methods that we use, and then the combination or triangulation of those methods into different cases that would kind of lead to the third section of the book, which are case studies. So people from publishers or other like a small or bigger studios, they wrote how they do game user research. And that's basically what we hope we can achieve. So we talk about the production, we talk about the method and how it's been applied. So in terms of the timeline, we are submitting the book to the publisher end of March, and we are hoping that I think by September, October, the book should be available. We probably have a few more minutes if you have any specific question you want to ask. There is a website as well.
Gearbook.com. GURbook.com, one word.
But there is a website that you can check the list of advisors. You can see the current timeline, which is that we are slightly behind that. But there's going to be the money.
We're only a year behind. It's okay.
Well, that's the challenge. But working or having authors from the industry and us as super busy But we hope that the end result is going to be something amazing and something that the whole community has contributed to and can benefit from, hopefully.
I was going to share an anecdote that two out of the three editors changed jobs during the time of this book production. So yeah, that is also part of the delay. Anyways.
So thanks again for your contribution. We are happy to answer any questions you may have or contact us.
So, with the new revised timeline, when are we going to get to see the book?
So, as I said,
before the end of the year.
Yeah, so basically, end of quarter three or quarter four, 2017.
Oxford promised us that it's going to be published within the year if we deliver by March.
End of March. It should be
calendar. Yeah, not fiscal. Jesus.
Yeah, if we deliver end of March, that means that it will be published in 2017. So yep. That's our current.
Out of interest, did you take a user-centered design approach to the book? Did you ask students trying to get into the field what they wanted to see?
I actually did, yes. So we have a luxury of having so many students. We love them so much. And they actually read the book and gave us feedback on what should be in there and like what they think is missing from the chapter that's written and what can be useful for them. So we wrote back to the authors and asked them to include the stuff that would benefit the students, definitely, yeah.
Excellent.
Also, in terms of price, we know that obviously they don't want to spend lots of money on books. Yeah. So that's one of the main things that we wanted to have something affordable for them, especially like we are both teaching, as well as Andres and many of our academic colleagues, we are teaching courses on game user research. And we didn't want to feel like we are forcing the students to buy some expensive book. So that would be cheap, yeah.
Like you wanted them to want to buy the book and not have to have.
Any more questions?
And if you have contributed to the book, you're going to receive a free copy. So as authors and advisory board, you will have a free copy for contributing to the book.
Also, we're totally throwing a party next year, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, maybe.
Cool.
Okay, so thank you.
Thanks again.
I'm Jenny Tremaine, and I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about creating positive video game characters with a focus on female characters. So the perception has been, historically, that video games are for boys, and this has led to content that has been created for boys, primarily white men specifically. And when females are in games, they are more likely to be represented in a sexualized way. So this has been represented in the literature, and it's also documented colloquially if you just look at games and if you think about some of your favorite games as well. So what we did is, from a research standpoint at our studio, is we want to know what features of characters appeal to gamers. So what do they want? So if we know that women are represented in a sexualized way in games, that's not good, so what should we do instead? And how can we use this information to create positive video game characters? And we did a lot of research, but I don't have time to talk about very much of it today. But one thing that we started off doing was with a survey. We did about 100 people to ask people about their character preferences for video games. We also did female-only focus groups and male-only focus groups as well, but I'm not going to be talking about that today. Within our survey, we asked a lot of different questions, but one thing that we did was we provided images of female video game characters, and we asked them, based on looks alone, what do you think of this character? And we asked them to rate it on a 1 to 5 scale, where 1 is if you dislike this character and 5 is if you like this character. And one thing that we found was something pretty interesting. So what I've done here is ranked the characters from most like to least like, and what we can do is categorize them. One thing that we noticed immediately is that characters that are highly recognizable are highly liked, and those are coded in blue. So if you're familiar with the character, you rate them pretty high. Next, what we did is I categorized them based on their attire. So characters that were wearing more functional or more armored clothing versus characters that were more sexy or naked. And if you can see here, we have the ratings from our female participants and our male participants. And what was great and maybe a little bit was surprising is that for both genders, functional attire is more important than sexiness. So for men, you can see in red is sexy. It's maybe a little bit more distributed. That's okay. But up at the top, what we see here is that people, characters that are dressed in a functional way is more important. So it was really interesting for us because we learned that you aren't turning men away by creating less sexy characters. And I'm not saying that you should be the boob police either. You can create, really the goal is just to be, to create something for everyone. So I think what's important is that we as researchers, we can be advocates for this. We can come to our studios and tell them, you know, why they should be doing this. And I have tons and tons more data and I'd love to share it with you. But there are signs that this is where the field is moving, and I think we can help give it a push. This is an article from the New York Times. It was published in December 2015, so it's a little bit older now, but their headline was Lara Croft has company. So they're saying that there are more females in games. But, you know, we can make it happen faster. This is Aloy from Horizon Zero Dawn, which came out today. Strong female character. I'm super excited about it. I hope you guys are too. Can check it out. Women and also minorities play games. There's also lots of documented data supporting this, which I have and I'm happy to share. So what we should do is create content that they want to buy. Women, they're playing games and they're largely ignored by the market. So we want to give them something that they want. And we're not, we learned from our research that we're not turning away male gamers. So I want to move from having no girls allowed to having something for everyone. Identification with characters is important. So this is also well documented in the literature, and it is something that we hear from our participants as well. If you identify with characters, you're more motivated, you're more interested in the game that you're playing. And we want to create that for all of the people who are playing our games. So we should eliminate the barrier to entry for women and also for minorities by creating something that they can identify with. So in the future, I would love to walk you all through the full results that we have on our character data that we found. So we focused on female video game characters, but we talked to both men and women, and we learned a lot about both genders, about what each are looking for in characters. I would love partnerships with you and your teams to share this information and to try and help spread the promotion of awesome characters, specifically female characters, and expanded research that maybe we can do together. So my contact info is there. You can contact me. And are there any questions? Yes, we need mics or just ask.
Yeah, I was just wondering, you said you have all this data. Have you published any of this data? Are you interested in that?
I haven't published. I think the hard part, so my background is in academia, so it would be great to publish. But when you work with the studios, your sample sizes are pretty small, although I do have around 100 people now for a survey. And
so I'm in HCI. That's fine.
Okay. but there's not a lot of control when you're doing research because it's not designed to have the same level of control as you would for peer research, but it's definitely possible.
It might still be possible.
Yeah.
Are you interested in that?
Sure.
Okay, cool.
As far, I mean, also within the content, as long as it's not...
Yeah, limitations on the company.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, thank you very much. So yeah, it's definitely, I'm definitely seeing like, as the industry's going on and like recently, there's been more prominent like female protagonists, and it's great. One thing I notice kind of an absence of though, is like there's not a lot of portrayals of like relationships or couples in games. And it was really interesting when Uncharted 4 came out recently, how well like the married couple was actually received, and a lot of people really liked it. And I was wondering, is that something that came up in your research at all? Is it something people mentioned or they're looking for?
As far as characters specifically in relationships, it did not. There was a lot of things came up about couples playing together and how what they look for in characters and how they play together, but not couples in games. No, it didn't.
Cool. Thanks.
So I'm a grad student, so I'm still learning a lot about everything. But the biggest thing that you talked about is that kind of ignoring that a lot of people do, when you present them with this idea. Is there a good way that you can encourage people to support kind of the argument that inclusivity is generally a good path, even when people are like, oh, it's not our target audience or things like that?
Yes, yeah. So that was something that I had to work with within our studio, is trying to convince the teams, the higher ups, on why does this matter. And there, I do have more supporting data, but really, you know, the things that I talked about where the field is changing, we need to do that. And you can encourage your studio, like, well, we should be a leader because we don't want to get left behind. That's one way. And we know that women do play games. There's a lot of evidence for this, and they do primarily play more mobile games than console games. But you know, why is that? Maybe one reason is because they don't have, there aren't games that they want to play, they don't have characters that they can identify with. And actually, there is some academic literature that supports that. Mobile games have a stronger and higher female representation. I was looking up some games and some images, and my favorite is this one. It's called I don't remember the title, but it's like, she's an FBI agent. She's wearing like a buttoned up shirt, and I'm like, wow, that's awesome. She's FBI and she's wearing something appropriate. And so, you know, maybe these are some of the factors that are bringing women more towards mobile, and that we can do things to bring them to console. Is there a question way in the back?
I was wondering if you looked at the interplay between what the characters are wearing and then also the personality that they're portrayed with. So one of the things, I'm an Overwatch player, Symmetra comes to mind. She was listed as being sexy on the female list, but the males didn't list her there. At least it wasn't there. And I wonder...
She might have been... I had to kind of cut down my sample size because of... I added... For the males, I had to add male gamers. Or male characters as well. But I'd have to go back and look for sure.
Because I'm just wondering, like, most of the guys that I talk to, they describe Symmetra as, like, cold and sterile, even though she's wearing very revealing clothes. Right. And so I just wonder how that impacts the research.
Great question. When I first started doing this research, Overwatch was not released yet. So people were not familiar with the characters, because then otherwise some of them would be highly recognizable. And then my guess is that they would rate much higher. So that was kind of a benefit for me, because Overwatch, they made an effort to create a wide range of different characters. And the fact that they weren't well known because it wasn't released yet helped out that a lot. So it wasn't a confounding factor in this study.
So I was fortunate enough to work with BioWare on Dragon Age, and then I worked with DICE on Mirror's Edge. So I've been fortunate to work in a very female gamer-friendly team space.
Sure.
And I just want to say, like, all of the research that I did, bringing in a lot of guys to play in, like, Dragon Age, bringing in guys to play Mirror's Edge, I was very pleasantly surprised, and I'm a pretty hard cynic, at the number of guys who were like, oh, wow, Faith is a really cool character. And, like, there's no pandering to the male gaze or... Like, there's no, she is an attractive character, but she's a strong female character. Like, there's no sexualization overtly about it. Mm-hmm. And that really appealed to a lot of the guys, where it's like, this is a really cool character.
Strength,
like,
over
she kicks
sex
ass.
Was coming.
Yeah, the strength
was really
surprising. Mm-hmm. And then, I mean, the BioWare fan base, obviously, for those that are familiar, has a very strong cohort of female players. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting because one of the things I looked at early in the research was what characters people wanted to play as. And the characters that had like functional combat armor and stuff like that just rated way higher. Like Cassandra in that game is like walking around like full plate and she's a badass. And she was one of our top rated characters consistently throughout because people could easily identify her, even amongst male gamers.
Yep.
They were like, she's going to be a really strong tank. I understand because she's in like full armor, carries around a cool shield. It was just really, really good. I'm wondering if you have any examples of like any games in particular from your research that are like that high watermark that we can use as examples, especially at the AAA level of like, look, this is other companies that are doing this really well.
Yeah. So I wouldn't call out a game specifically, but what I would say is one thing that we asked in our survey was to provide an example of an ideal male character and an ideal female character for you, you know, that represents their gender well, that is a positive example of this gender video game character for you. And we had them state what it was and then an open-ended where they said why. And so they just listed out the things that they like and then went through and coded what themes are appearing. And so there are a number of themes that appeared for both men and for women. So I would say, you know, those themes are more important. And so some of them were identification, one either like masculinity for males or strength for female characters. So, and that was across genders. There were several themes that, you know, were the same for gender and then a few that were discrepant between genders. And so I have all that data. I don't, off the top of my head, it's not, I'm not, you know, giving you all the information, but so that is one thing. And I feel like I had something else, but maybe I don't remember. Yeah, so I would just say like the themes would be something to focus on. One other thing that you mentioned earlier was about female-centric game teams. I think that's incredibly important because one thing that was lacking where I was working is that there weren't any female designers and that they didn't have a female opinion or voice to bounce any of this off of. And so I was like, hey, just come to show me. I will be that person. So which the game industry is more male dominated. And if you have the opportunity, just insert yourself in there. I don't have an art background. I don't have a design background, but like I am a woman and I can add something to this conversation. So.
Okay. I don't know which one of you is first. Nah, I'm just blaming myself. Okay.
I was wondering if you did any research beyond the binary, even with how trans women at least view women in games and how that affects them. Because that's something that I don't see touched upon a lot. It's typically just cis males and cis females.
I didn't, but that's something that's super interesting for, you know, expanded research. One thing that did came up quite a bit in the open-ended was that androgynous was really positive. For women especially.
Hello, so I'm Graham. I run Player Research, which is an independent games user research studio in the UK. And that word will be important, as you'll see. Being independent means we do not work just within one studio. We do not work just for EA or Ubisoft or a mobile studio. We work for all of those things. And what that means is I spend the vast majority of my time talking to game developers. And I would say it's about 200 a year, different studios. So I speak to a lot of developers. We work on 60 games a year. And to get those 60 games, it means you have to talk to hundreds of people that eventually leads to that work. Now, what's interesting is you are probably all in a bubble. When I say user research, you know what I mean, probably. You'll be surprised that most of the games industry has no idea. And to put that in perspective, of the hundreds of people I talk to every year who talk to me and say we want something done, none of them, zero, uses the word user research. Zero. So just bear in mind, you're in a bubble and you know what this means. Most of the game industry is not familiar with this language. So why is this interesting? It's interesting because those 200 people plus that I speak to a year, 200 different studios, I have to explain to them every single time what we do. Every single time. they are not used to it. And so over the time, this is the diagram I keep in my mind. I don't show them this. This is not something to be presented to them, not yet anyway. But it's something I certainly have in my head that I talk through. So how this normally happens is they'll phone up and say, we need a focus group test. Well, insert inappropriate word here, right? What they mean is that they probably need a play test. And the reason they say that word is because it's the only user research method they know. So across the top of this diagram, you've all the different methods that we use within player research. The only one most studios have heard about is probably play testing or maybe a concept test. Maybe. That'll come under different names like market research and yeah. It's very confusing already, isn't it? So you can see why this sort of diagram is needed. I'm going to just talk through some bits of it that may help you explain to studios why you need more methods and why it's going to help them. So this bit down the side where it says monetization, player experience, usability, learnability, appeal, these are the five layers that we talk about within player research. So these five layers are very important from the player perspective. You can think of this section here as important to the player. So bear in mind, a lot of the games we work on, about 60%, are probably mobile free to play. But that's blurring too. Business models blur. You have console games which are free to play too, or console games which are premium, but you can make in-app purchases. It's very gray indeed. Anyway, at the top, most companies want to make money. Who would have thought? They want the player to give them money. And by the way, that's a good thing. The player should want to give money, because then you have more of the good experience. It's not a negative. You're not tricking them. This should be a good thing. So at the very top is some sort of, we want to get money from the player. The player should want to pay us. So why do players give money? Well, players give money because the game is good. And if you're enjoying the game, paying a little bit of money should extend the experience. We all pay for good experiences. That's not a shock, right? I'm enjoying this. If I pay more, maybe I can extend the experience. That's fine. So getting the player to pay relies on making a great game. The fourth layer down. Fourth layer. So what's a great game mean? This player experience layer. What stops all games being amazing? Well, what we see is the next layer beneath that is usability. Can the player do what the designer wants them to do? But what stops the player doing that? Well, that's learnability or understanding or cognition. Does the player know the rules of the game? It's learnability layer. But of course, they're never going to download it unless it appeals to begin with. If you don't like car games, you're not going to download a car game. If you don't like Match 3 games, you're not going to download them. So this appeal layer, it has to be something unique about your game or something interesting that gets you as far as getting that game in the first place, either going into a store or buying it, or downloading it from Xbox or PlayStation or Steam, or the App Store or Google Play. It has to be something interesting. Could be word of mouth, could be many things. So these five things are very dependent on each other. The player has to download it, they have to understand the rules of the game, they have to be able to do the thing the designer wants. If they can't do those things, they're certainly not going to enjoy it, the player experience. And if they don't enjoy it, well, they're certainly not giving you money. If your game's premium, by the way, just ignore the top layer. The other four layers apply equally as well. So when I talk to developers, these five layers are critically important to making a hit game from the player perspective. Across the top is all the methods we use to polish those five layers. So these layers have to be polished within an inch of their life. How do you do that? Well, that's the different methods that we use. Concept testing, competitor analysis, collaborative design, expert analysis, sometimes called heuristic analysis, usability playtesting, large-scale playtesting for the experience, and maybe engagement diaries and things like that, so long-term understanding. You probably worked out by now, but the larger dot means that method helps the most for that layer. As an example, if you want to increase the usability of your game, you could do a usability playtest. Not a shock, I know, but you could do. But you could also do a competitor analysis. Oh, we had a laser pointer. You could do collaborative design, sitting beside the designers. You have other methods available. So when companies say things like, oh, we need a playtest, like, well, why do you need that? Or if they say things like, maybe, we just want to know if our game's fun. We want a large-scale playtest. We would never recommend you jump straight to that because you're also assessing usability issues in addition to the user experience. So you can see the trend line here is we get the easy things like learnability and usability out of the way quite early on during the game design, concept design phase, and then we work our way, the trend line's up to the right, to the harder stuff like, is it fun? Or would the player pay? These are much more complicated questions to answer than usability type stuff. So this diagram can help you structure your questions and help designers, you can explain to designers that there's more methods available. 1 minute already? Okay. You can explain to them, hey, you came to us for a playtest. Did you know there is seven more methods available or six more methods available to help you polish your game. And the people we speak to, the answer usually is, we do not know that. And for companies who only do playtesting, this method here, you can playtest forever, but it's only one method. You're never going to understand really about more complex questions like, do players enjoy my game? Because the sample size is too low. Or would they pay in this game? Or would they, what about a 2-week experience or a 1-month experience? You're never going to answer those questions if you're only doing usability testing. So these methods are shining different lenses on these five layers, which we know are important to the player experience. This is the stuff players talk about. These are sorts of issues that come up in game reviews, either Metacritic or the Google Play Store, or all those sorts of places. So if these five layers are critically important to making a hit game, these are the things you really need to do to polish all five layers. And having this single view, we only do playtesting. That is never enough. And hopefully this diagram helps you structure your thoughts around explaining to developers, this is why it's not enough. This method only polishes these layers. You need to polish all the layers. So you need more methods. Am I done? I'm done. Okay, thank you. One or two quick ones, okay.
Okay, so first question, can we steal this? Yes. How much can we steal this? Yeah, like... Yeah, like, do you have a trademark on this? Like, okay, cool. Just, no, just, okay. Yeah, I'm going to steal it, good. Okay. And then the next question. Yeah, yeah, it should be. It should be in there, yeah. Is it Benjamin? Okay, good. So... Engagement diaries, you say engagement diaries are really good for monetization. How and why? I don't get that part. Tell me.
If you're doing a usability study, which lasts for 40 minutes, yeah. And you say to someone, would you pay? That's not enough time to make an informed decision around, how is this item used? How does it benefit me in the game? But if you're playing, if someone's playing the game for 2 weeks or a month, they have time to see how that character is used, or do they want to upgrade it? Do they want to pay to extend that experience or a building? So most monetization, people rarely buy within 40 minutes of downloading a game. They do buy within maybe the first few days or 7 days or 14 days.
So the monetization strategy doesn't exist beforehand, but you're actually finding what to monetize.
No, well, so for us, when we say monetization, by the way, we're interested in the usability of monetization. So what were you interested in buying? How did you feel about that? Was it satisfying? Did it do what you expected? It's not about, you know, graphs and spreadsheets and, you know, you should charge $2.99 for this item. That's definitely not our job at all. So what you could think of is monetization is really these three layers, learnability, usability, and player experience. You can imagine those rolled into monetization. So it's the understandability of making a purchase. It's the usability of making a purchase. It's the experience of making a purchase. I've only got a few minutes to explain that stuff. So yeah. It's pretty good. You should read it. any other questions? Got to go? Okay, no then.
Yeah, it should work. Oh, you want to take that? Yay, works like a train. All right, I have 30 slides and I have 8 minutes. So I'm just gonna roll them through and I'm gonna make it. And then we're gonna be finished and we can save the questions for the social hangout. I'll be there. Happy to take any questions at that point. So, hi everyone, I'm Elina Ollila, and I work for my own UX design and research consultancy, UXFIT. We are based in San Diego, and we focus on games and entertainment products. I've been doing user research and other UX work for games for about 15 years now. So I'll give first a super quick peek on how things were done back then. And then I'll give a few practical tips how to work with advanced technologies today in area of mobile games user research. So in the good old days, how many of you worked with these lovely DV tapes? I definitely don't miss it. It was awful. When I started working on games UX at Nokia, I used to do it almost daily. So happy we don't need to do it anymore. Here are a couple of slides from my TDC 2008 presentation. We used to attach these fantastic mini cameras with all sort of wires and duct tape to mobile phones, because the mobile phones were just so maxed out when you were running a game on it and players were playing. You couldn't really do anything else. We would bring players to labs. I know this still happens, but that was really the only option. We would have cameras to record their face, their body language to analyze their emotion later, and then everything was combined into one video. And it wasn't uncommon at all to need a bunch of engineers to rush in and fix everything when things started breaking. But things are different today. This wonderful little device, your mobile phone, it basically becomes your user research lab. It has it all. It's powerful. You can run games simultaneously and record the gameplay. You can use the touchscreen to record where the player is touching. You can record even with front-facing camera player's face at the same time. You can take it anywhere with you. So there is not really any reason to not to leave the building. Get out there. We've been hearing it throughout the day today already by other speakers as well. Next, I'll show you a couple of quick tips of four tools that I use with mobile games user research. So this is something I particularly like. It's called lookback.io. There are other tools, similar tools out there, but I'm using this as an example because I'm very familiar with it. So you can see there, I'm capturing the player's face, the game at the same time, and the microphone is used to record the player's voice. The only thing that's really missing comparing to the old methods that were used is the player's hovering finger, where you could see the hesitation. They might be just about to tap something, but then they don't. And those are usually quite interesting moments, actually, but you just need to be observant when you're using these tools. No downloading videos, a big plus. I can remember hours and hours trying to figure out what is a secure enough way for your client to get the videos up somewhere. Maybe you need to carry a USB stick. Your team can collaborate on the timeline, put comments in, share video snippets to focus the attention to the important parts of the research. Also, the mobile phone can be quite easily plugged into easy-to-use analytics tools. For instance, I've been using Mixpanel quite a bit. There are a lot of others out there as well. So using these tools, you have great sources for quantitative data and qualitative data. And the quantitative will tell you what's happening in the scale, whereas then the qualitative will more answer to the questions why it is happening. Combining these two together will make you be able to make more informed design decisions. Couple of stories from the wild. 5 years ago, we started to work on an unannounced puzzle mobile game. And we wanted to find out how to make the game as accessible as possible for women in their 30s and 40s who don't necessarily identify themselves as gamers, but are definitely interested in games. And we were particularly interested in iPhone users. At the time, I was spending a lot of time watching football games and cheerleading because my kids were doing that. And I realized there was almost an untapped source of playtest participants there who had a lot of time to waste. Meanwhile, they were waiting for their kids to perform. So quick question, how many potential test participants you can see in this picture? Maybe a couple. There is one. You can see another one. And her, she's probably too young. So not her. So this helped us to tap to an easy to access, almost unlimited source of target players, and we captured a lot of useful data. And a funny little story here. A couple of years after, I happened to notice this article in, or confession in the Parents magazine, where a cheerleading mom was confessing that she missed her daughter's beat a level in this game. And it was studied exactly like test participants, exactly like her, only if she knew. Another quick story. I promise it will be super, super quick. another project that we worked on was a location-based mobile game based on a popular Dragon IP. And we tried to figure out how to make the test situation as realistic as possible, being able to collect the location-based data and user research data at the same time. And the target audience for this audience was young kids. And the problem there was that since the audience was kids, we were really worried how nervous they would be in the test situation. And what we came up with was this very friendly user research truck. Would you get in? The solution was, though, that we invited the parent to ride with a kid, and we had very little any technical equipment there. It was just a device, and we had a GoPro as a backup as well in the situation, though, as well. There is a picture of the truck, and I'm wrapping up in 6 minutes. So get out of the building, embrace the qualitative data. I really love it. Even if big data is fantastic as well, it will tell you the whys. And get creative with latest research tools. And here is actually something that I really want to get to my user research setup, eye tracking for mobile games. They are also at the TDC Expo if you want to check them out, Toby. So I want to get one of these toys for myself. Thank you so much. Let's save the questions for the party.